Welcome to the class. We are starting with a new chapter, which is nutrition and health. First of all, we'll start with assessment of nutritional status. How do we assess the nutritional status of the population? As you can see on your slide, you have various things which we use. We have clinical examinations, anthropometry, biochemical and laboratory investigations, functional assessment, assessment of dietary intake, vital statistics, and assessment of ecological factors. So these are the various measurements by which we directly and indirectly gauge the nutritional status of the population. First, let us start with clinical examination. Clinical examinations which are not directly related to nutrition are alopecia, pyorrhea, and pterygium. Which need further investigation are malar pigmentation, corneal vascularization, and geographic term. So these are signs which we don't know for sure are associated with malnutrition but are into suspected category. Of known value are angular stomatitis, Bittott spot, absence of knee jerk in beriberi, and enlargement of thyroid in goiter. So these are the clinical examinations which we know are of value as far as nutrition is concerned. The drawbacks of clinical examination are malnourished cannot be quantified. As we saw, there is a lot of subjective variation. Every doctor, every examiner may have his or her own expertise or opinion about a particular clinical case, and they may vary. Therefore, quantification is going to be a huge problem. There are no physical signs for some diseases. Most notable again, hypertension, diabetes. People have them for decades together, but they have no complaints. Lack of specificity and subjective nature of most of the physical signs. This is another problem with assessment of nutrition by just clinical examination. Hence, we take the help of anthropometry. Anthropometry means measurement of the body. We have height, weight, head circumference, chest circumference, and mid-arm circumference. These are the measurements which are routinely taken. Head circumference is important in babies. As you know, in babies, when a child is born, the head circumference is greater than the chest circumference. So the widest part of the human body at birth is the head. At 6 months of age, about 6 to 9 months of age, the head circumference matches with the chest circumference. After this, the chest circumference is bigger than the head circumference. If this fails to occur, it could be a sign of malnutrition. Laboratory and biochemical assessment. You have lab values, hemoglobin, stool and urine for parasite and ova. Measuring individual nutrients, you can measure serum retinol, serum iron. These are specific individual nutrient measurements. We come to biochemical tests. You can have metabolites in the urine, urinary iodine, and enzymes can be measured for vitamin deficiencies. Drawbacks of these, they are time consuming and they are expensive. These investigations do not come cheap and therefore they are not feasible on a very large scale. Coming to the functional indicators, you have lot of examples, not very frequently tested, but can be tested in other subjects also. So let us have a look at that. Erythrocyte fragility, vitamin E is an indicator for that. Deficiency of vitamin E can cause erythrocyte fragility. Deficiency of vitamin C can increase capillary fragility. Host defenses, protein energy malnutrition cause problem in leukocyte chemotaxis. Similarly, vitamin K causes problems with prothrombin time. Reproduction, sperm count is directly correlating with the energy resources of the body. And dark adaptation could be an indicator of vitamin A deficiency. Assessment of dietary intake. So this is another approach for the nutritional monitoring. You can have weighment of raw foods, weighment of cooked foods, oral questionnaire method, and stroke inventory method. We'll just have a rapid look of what these things are. Weighment of raw food means each day before the meal is cooked, whatever is being cooked on that day is weighed and then it is cooked. This is a more popular method of weighing. The second method is weighment of cooked food. Since the cooked food is already cooked, you may have some resistance. People may not allow you to weigh their cooked foods. Oral questionnaire method is just a questionnaire is given to the people and they are asked to write down whatever they ate on a particular day. Stock inventory is taking stock of whatever food stock is available in the house on a monthly basis or a quarterly basis or 15 days, fortnightly basis. So that is stock inventory. Vital statistics. Mortality and morbidity data can be used. They are very vaguely associated with the nutritional status of the community. Of course, they are not a direct measure. And assessment of ecological factors. You have food balance sheet. This is done on a national level, not a local level. Socioeconomic factors such as family size, occupation, income, education, health and educational services, and conditional influences such as parasites, bacteria, and viruses. As you already know, these are going very, very broad. They are not a direct measure, but would give you an idea of the nutritional status broadly. Coming to nutritional surveillance and nutritional monitoring. We saw that surveillance and monitoring sometimes are used synonymously, and we also saw that that is not the case. So let us have a look at this issue from the nutritional standpoint. What is nutritional surveillance? Keeping a watch over the nutrition in order to make decisions that will lead to improvement of nutrition in the populations is nutritional surveillance. The objectives are to aid long-term planning in health and development, to improve input for program management and evaluation, and to give timely warnings and interventions to prevent short-term food consumption crisis. So these are the objectives of nutritional surveillance. Growth monitoring. Individual child is important in growth monitoring as opposed to nutritional surveillance, wherein we were concerned with everybody. As far as growth monitoring is concerned, each and every individual child is important. Month-to-month assessment is done. It is done to promote continued growth and development. Remember growth chart? And enrollment ideally should be done before the age of 6 months. Here you have a table where we compare growth monitoring to nutritional surveillance. On the left hand side you can see is growth monitoring and on the right hand side is nutritional surveillance. We'll just see the table in brief. Strategy in growth monitoring is prevention of normal growth. The approach is educational and motivational. Enrollment of all infants is done in growth monitoring and it starts before 6 months of age. Small groups are used in growth monitoring. Who records the weight? The mother records the weight. Weight card is simple. Nutritional emphasis is maintained on good nutrition. Early home-based intervention are advocated and brief resumption of normal growth. That is the response time. Response time is short and resumption of growth is rapid. Comparing this with nutritional surveillance, the strategy is the detection of undernutrition. It is of diagnostic value. Nutritional surveillance is used on a representative sample. Everybody is not included, but a representative sample is used. Representative ages are taken at longer intervals. The group would more often than not be very large for surveillance. The measurements are taken by trained workers. The weight card is very precise. It detects malnutrition. Nutritional rehabilitation with supplements is the response in case malnutrition is detected. And the response time is obviously long because the data on a very large scale is compiled, it is sent, it is analyzed, and if the malnutrition is a significant problem, the intervention is introduced. So therefore, there is a long lag time between the surveillance and the intervention. With that, we see the difference coming to milk. Milk-borne infections primarily to man. Milk is an important topic. It is a small topic, but it is important. A lot of questions can be based upon milk. So we'll briefly see what is important here. Direct infections to man are typhoid and paratyphoid, shigellosis, cholera, and enteropathogenic E. coli. So these are diarrheal diseases which can be caused because of milk. Non-diarrheal diseases because of milk are streptococcal infections, staphylococcal food poisoning, diphtheria, tuberculosis, a notable example, enterovirus, and viral hepatitis. So a lot of diseases can be transmitted through milk. Therefore, we need protection against these diseases, and that protection is afforded by something called as pasteurization of milk. I am sure most of you would have heard about pasteurization. Pasteurization may be defined as the heating of milk to such temperatures and for such periods as required to destroy any pathogen while causing minimal changes in the composition, flavor, and nutritive value of the milk. Pasteurization is heating milk to destroy the pathogens. So that, simply put, is what pasteurization means. Methods. You have three methods of pasteurization: the Holder method, the HTST method, and the UHT method. Let us see what these are. Holder method is also called as the VAT method, wherein the milk is heated to 63 to 66 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes and then quickly cooled. This method is not important because it is not frequently used. HTST is high temperature, short time method. The milk is rapidly boiled to 72 degrees centigrade for 15 seconds and then cooled rapidly to 4 degrees centigrade. Therefore, it is called as high temperature, short time, just for 15 seconds, and therefore the name. The next is ultra high temperature method, UHT. UHT method, the milk is boiled in two stages. The second stage is done under pressure. Under pressure, because you know, under pressure the temperature of water can be increased above 100. Same holds true for milk also. Look at the temperature. In UHT method, in the second step, milk is boiled to 125 degrees centigrade for a few seconds and then it is cooled. How to test if the pasteurization is successful? These are the tests that you see. You have a phosphatase test, you have the standard plate count, and the coliform count. In front of these tests are the important interpretations that should be known of these tests. For example, for phosphatase test, the interpretation that is useful is there should be no phosphatase present. After pasteurization, phosphatase must be completely destroyed. So the remnants of phosphatase must not be there. Second is the standard plate count, and maximum 30,000 should be the count which is allowable. Above 30,000, there should not be the count of bacteria. Coliform count should obviously be nil. Coliform are a contaminant and they should therefore be nil. Coming to food toxicants. Food toxicants. The first toxin we are going to see here is aflatoxin. It is a storage fungus called as Aspergillus flavus, which secretes aflatoxin. This is important, is asked in the examination, is a very high yield MCQ material. The toxins of Aspergillus flavus is aflatoxin, and the components are B1 and G1, both are hepatotoxic. Aflatoxin infects rice, wheat, and groundnuts. Usually, if the groundnuts are not heated, they are stored as such for very long times. Aspergillus flavus grows into them and it secretes aflatoxin, which are hepatotoxic. Moisture is important, and the prevention is done by decreasing moisture content to less than 10%. A practical suggestion would be airtight storage of the groundnut and other foodstuffs. Next, coming to ergot poisoning. Have you ever heard ergot? I am sure you have, and you should have heard that in pharmacology. So ergot poisoning. Field fungus is Claviceps fusiformis, which secretes ergot. It is, remember, a very powerful vasoconstrictor. Ergot is a very powerful vasoconstrictor, and Claviceps fusiformis makes ergot. It causes painful cramps and severe vasoconstriction that may actually lead to gangrene. So this is such a powerful vasoconstrictor. Claviceps fusiformis infects bajra and wheat. Prevention is done by floating these bajra or wheat in 20% salt solution. So that is the prevention against ergot poisoning. These are important points. Just the highlights are written so that you are not boggled with a lot of detail. So therefore, please try to remember as much as these problems are concerned, because they are high yield. Coming to epidemic dropsy. Mustard oil is mixed with Arjemon oil and the problem starts. You have a disease which is epidemic dropsy. This is an example where adulteration plays havoc. The symptoms are bilateral swelling of legs and feet. You can have diarrhea, dyspnea and cardiac failure. So serious symptoms. Tests to detect the contamination are nitric acid test, and the interpretation is orange red color detects contamination. Other tests that can be done is paper chromatography. So paper chromatography and nitric acid test are used to detect contamination. Okay, mustard oil is mixed with Arjemon oil in epidemic dropsy. Coming to endemic ascites. Endemic ascites is a disease which is caused because of weeds. Crotalaria seeds are mixed with millet, gondli. These Crotalaria seeds get mixed so well with gondli that it is very difficult to separate them. If they are used together, you get a disease which is called as endemic ascites. The toxin secreted is hepatotoxic, and prevention is done by de-weeding, sieving the millet and educating the people about this problem. You have massive ascites and the fatality can also be very high. So therefore, it is important to recognize this and also to remember the solutions. De-weeding will solve the root cause of the problem. So the plants, the weeds would be removed. Sieving the millet will filter out the contaminating Crotalaria seeds and educating the people that the problem exists so that they take steps to control it. Coming to food additives. Adding non-food substances to food products is an established practice. Non-nutritious substances which are added intentionally to food, generally in small quantities, improve its texture, appearance and flavor or storage properties. So there are a lot of additives which are added to the food. This definition also includes animal food adjuncts which may retain in residues in human food components of packaging materials which may find their way to the food. So you have animal food adjuncts which are added, plus the materials from the packaged food which leach out into the food. These are all included in food additives. These food additives are categorized. The first category of food additives is coloring agents such as saffron and turmeric, flavoring agents such as vanilla, sweeteners such as saccharin, preservatives such as sorbic acid and sodium benzoate, acidity imparting agents such as citric acid. These are generally considered to be safe. So class 1 food additives are generally considered to be safe. Coming to the class 2 food additives. These are incidental during the process of packaging or processing or farming. So these are not direct, these are indirect. These are because of the leaching of materials from the packaging or the processing or some problems with the farming practices. So substances which find their way into our foods by this method are called as class 2 or category 2 food additives. Obviously, the safety of these is doubtful. Food fortification. The process whereby nutrients are added to the foods in relatively small quantities to maintain or improve the quality of a diet of a group, community or population is called as food fortification. Thank you.